It was the night an out-of-town girlfriend came to see me play as captain of the Bluebirds basketball team. My moment came late in the second half. This was it, my time to shine, my time to prove my masculinity to her and everyone in those stands, hell, everyone in the town. After flashing the lane for a steal, the crowd was cheering and I was wide open for an uncontested layup. That fall, in 1965, a long and rich basketball tradition had descended to my shoulders as captain of the Mount Pleasant Bluebirds basketball team. At 5'7", descended was an apt description. Just as the winds of change were blowing across the nation that year, the fortunes of that storied team were about to change as we entered the worst season in the annals of Bluebird basketball. Class B schools, the designation used in those days, without the population, resources, or desire to support a football team, were prevalent in rural north central Arkansas. Roundball had been preparing youth in the Ozark foothills for the game of life and teaching the virtues of discipline since the post-World War II era began. As in many rural areas of the state, basketball was king in Izzard County. Although the county seat was and is still in Melbourne, the basketball capital was Mount Pleasant, home to those mighty Bluebirds. It seemed as though Mount Pleasant had always had winning seasons and most years dominated the likes of intra-county rivals Melbourne, Oxford, Violet Hill, and Calico Rock. In the fall of 1965 in Mount Pleasant, it was, as they say, a simpler time and place. Drugs were not a problem. Just say no is what mothers told their daughters before the first date. Social class was not an issue because everyone was working class. Ethnic groups were non-existent, unless one counted relatives visiting from California. Izzard County, a dry county, meaning no legal alcohol sales, was surrounded by dry counties. It may not have been the buckle of the Bible Belt, but it was only a notch or two away. With a population of only 197, Mount Pleasant had five churches, including two kinds of Presbyterians. As in many small towns, the school's gymnasium was the largest building in town and second only to the pool hall as the cultural center. Basketball games and church services were as close as it got to formal affairs. Basketball coaches held celebrity status in the community and had the respect of their players. Our coach was also a nutrition expert and insisted that only a light snack be eaten early on the evening of a game day. Considered health food in those days, Hostess Twinkies were the favored recommendation. In 1965, every player over 5'9" had graduated the previous May. Desperate for height, coach collared a good old boy who had never played and handed him a uniform. He was at least a six-footer and played like he had at least 6 feet. The poor fella tripped over paint stripes, but he looked good on the bench. A lack of height was not the only challenge to my masculinity. Being an unfashionably late arrival to the puberty ball, my chest was barren, and armpit hair was nearly invisible. My chagrin heightened when I got word that my scarcity of testosterone had been observed by a certain high school girl commenting on the lack of underarm hair. While tank-style jerseys cover most of the chest, it is impossible to play basketball without raising your arms. I tried. If only teams had been wearing t-shirts under their jersey in those days, another aspect of my adolescent inferiority complex could have been concealed. Had I known about steroids in those days, drugs might have been a problem in Mount Pleasant. Lacking offensive prowess, I became a defensive specialist. At least in my mind. My highlight of the season occurred in a game with the number one team in the district who had the big red-headed guy, destined for the college ranks. His movements soon became predictable as he would catch the ball and lower it to his waist before spinning toward the basket. The next time he lowered the ball, I simply grabbed it from his hands and will never forget that look on his face as he looked toward his coach. Although more than four decades have passed, I feel certain that even today he relives that painful recollection of the humiliation I inflicted upon him. Suffer, big guy. A winning season was hopeless, and it was apparent that no amount of coaching could overcome the lack of height and talent. With no shot clock in those days, there were many nights when we slowed the pace and humbled our opponents by keeping them in double figures. Coach recognized our plight early in the season and gave us permission to lose gracefully and still enjoy the game. We still got excited before every game and played for the love of basketball. And so it was, for the love of the game, that fateful night that I found myself alone in the paint, wide open, not a defender in sight. I caught the ball, dribbled for my manhood-saving layup. The adrenaline was pumping through my whole body, and time stood still as the ball left my hand. It bounced so hard off the glass, it hit behind the free throw line. Looking toward the bench, I saw Coach's hands cover his eyes, and from the corner of my eye, I detected a frozen smile of embarrassment on my girlfriend's face. A player from the other team grabbed the ball, passed it to an open teammate for an easy jump shot. The buzzer sounded, the game was over. Just as Arkansans thank God for Mississippi and so many economic statistics, Mount Pleasant gave thanks for a hapless and winless team from Norfolk that year. Both teams were winless, and Norfolk had the home court advantage. Yet the Bluebirds prevailed in the final game of the regular season, and we knew what it was like to have at least one victory. The town bemoaned the sorry state of Bluebird basketball, but dealt no cruelty to the current stewards. There were no calls for a coaching change, and nary a boo was ever directed at the players, for we were the home team, regardless of the record. I've heard there are benefits to be gained from every experience. Although the town had never experienced such depths of losing, perhaps it provided a greater appreciation for the winning seasons destined to return again. Accustomed to seeking benefits on a much lower plane than Shirley MacLaine, I am not too thrilled by the abstraction of being a martyr team providing salvation for the town's future gratitude. Especially since the school fell victim to consolidation several years later, and now, sadly, Bluebird basketball is only a memory. As luck would have it, after graduation, I grew 4 inches taller and chest hair appeared. Okay, I only grew 2 inches, and the chest hair still leaves a little to be desired. Seriously, though, it did teach me persistence and determination in the face of superior odds. I gained a lifetime supply of humility and learned that just because you're a little short in some areas is never a reason not to play the game. The philosophically inclined and Visa commercials tell me an experience like this is priceless. I think about that missed layup and reply, make me an offer.